about mole and mass relationships. So remember how we talked about chemical compounds and how to put compounds together to make reactions? Now, guys, we're actually interested in the quantity behind these reactions. So what do we care about that for? What's so important about this is that if you look, all matter is either chemically or physically combined into substances. It is actually very difficult to find, for example, elements in their pure form. So some examples of why understanding quantity behind the actual substance is, for example, the amount of sodium and sodium chloride for FDA diet. The FDA recommends less than 2.4 grams of sodium ion per day. But get this, we don't eat elemental sodium. Sodium actually comes in sodium chloride, which is table salt. So the idea is, how much salt should I eat, or am I allowed to eat to maintain the FDA recommended dose, right? So, because again, I can't just eat sodium by itself. Another example is, I've told you guys before about iron ore and many ores that we find. Iron is not found in its natural, pure iron form, right? So it's usually found as an ore, which means that we have to extract it and purify the iron out. So I need to ask myself, how much, if I have this much ore, for example, how much iron can I extract from there? Another example is using hydrogen and water for hydrogen fuel. No doubt that you guys have heard of hydrogen fueled or powered cars, which is a way of exploration to replace petroleum sources, right? So the thing is, you can't really find hydrogen gas really easily. So we have to make it from water. So we split the water molecule into hydrogen gas and oxygen gas and collect that hydrogen gas. So how much water do I need to make the certain amount of hydrogen gas that I need to use for my fuel cell in a car? That's another great example. Now, if you think about CFCs, or chlorofluorocarbons, right, which is the chemical way of saying freons, freons are used as refrigerants, and they have chlorine compounds in them. These chlorine compounds go up into the stratosphere where they interact with the ozone layer. So they chemically interact and break down ozone. And when that happens, the ozone is no longer up there protecting us from UV radiation, allowing UV radiation to come right in and harm us genetically, causing cancers and all that terrible stuff. So how do I know how much damage I'm going to do to the ozone layer? Not me personally, but you know, our world is, I can estimate how much freons are we putting out there and how much chlorine is into the, or is in these freons. And so how much damage am I going to do to the ozone layer like that? So you see, quantity is super important. In this chapter, I will teach you how to figure that stuff out. But before we go on further, let me give you an analogy to help you understand how this stuff works, okay? So when you guys, let's say that you're building a house, you go to the hardware store, they don't sell pounds by counting. So you grab, they sell nails by putting them on a scale. So let's say that you grab 2.6 pounds of nails. The question is, how many nails is that actually going to be? Because guys, if you're building a house, it's not feasible to count 1, 2, 3, like 10,000 nails. You'll be sleeping over at the hardware store for some time, right? So the idea is to use some conversion factors that can take you from the pounds of nails to the actual number of nails. So you have to use some conversion factors. The hardware store tells you that one dozen of nails weighs 0.15 pounds. 0.150 pounds. And that one dozen of nails is 12 nails. So the way that we start this out is we start out always with our given here, guys. So you have 2.6 2.6 pounds. You can't really go from pounds to the number of nails because you don't have a direct conversion factor. You can go from pounds to dozen of nails, right? So the pounds cancel out. But I didn't ask how many dozens of nails. I want to know how many actual nails. So we'll keep going. One dozen is 12 nails. So multiply everything on the top, divide by everything on the bottom. That gives you a total of 208 nails. So the customer just bought 2.6 pounds of nails, which is equivalent to 208 nails. So he counted by weight. So you may ask, what does that have anything to do with chemistry? The analogy helps us understand what we call the chemist's dozen. The chemist's dozen, guys, is called the mole. The mole is the number of atoms in one mole of whatever substance that we're working with. So this is, guys, called Avogadro's number. So one mole is 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms or molecules or particles, depending on what you're dealing with, okay? We call that the chemist dozen because it's like saying one dozen has 12 things in it, right? I don't care what you're dealing with. One dozen of anything is 12. And one mole of anything, whether it's atoms, molecules, formula units, which together we call particles, is 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd. Okay, that's a lot larger than 12. We know that, right? So one dozen is 12. One mole is a lot more than that, but it is called the chemist's dozen. So the numerical value of the mole is defined as being equal to the number of atoms in exactly 12 grams of carbon 12. So Avogadro based his calculations on carbon 12. Had he chosen something else, all the masses on the periodic table will look completely different. So what does Avogadro do for us? He established a relationship between the mass of, let's say, carbon and the number of atoms of carbon. This really helps us count atoms because they're so teeny tiny small. It's really unfeasible to count how many atoms you have, right? Unless you're a particle physicist, right? But for us, we take, in our laboratories, we have a mass scale that gives us grams. This relationship helps us go from the mass to the number of moles, which is similar to the number of dozen, and then from the number of dozen to the actual number of teeny tiny particles that we have. So it's extremely feasible and much less expensive, right? Because you can just use a good analytical scale in the laboratory instead of high-tech equipment that costs on the order of millions of dollars, okay? So let's talk about some conversion factors. When we convert between the moles and the number of atoms, this is very similar to us converting between dozen of nails to the number of nails. So here, guys, it says convert 3.5 moles of helium to the number of helium atoms. Whenever you see moles, if it helps you figure it out, just sub in dozen. So this is like saying, if I have 3.5 dozen of nails, how many nails do I have? So if we had, let me do the nails first. 3.5 dozen of nails, how many moles is that? Since we have dozen on the top, we're gonna put dozen on the bottom and number of nails on the top. Okay, so guys, one dozen is 12 nails. So what you gotta do is you gotta take your 3.5 times 12. This is 42 nails. And I am writing with my finger, so pardon my sloppy handwriting. My stylus point is not working today. So guys, let's do now that analogy where we see dozen, let's now put mole. So we have 3.5 moles of helium, okay? So one mole of helium, guys, has how many things or atoms in it? 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms there of helium. So the moles of helium cancel out and I'm left with atoms. So let's do this as 3.5 times. And guys, around Avogadro's number, make sure you put parentheses depending on which calculator that you're using. You might get the wrong order of operations. If you guys are not getting the same answer that I am, please come see me ASAP and I'll teach you how to use your calculator. So guys, this amounts to, we're using two sig figs here, because that's, remember, you go by the least number of sig figs with multiplication division. So this ends up being 2.1 times 10 to the 24th atoms of helium. Okay? So that would be your answer. Now, let's do this the other way around. So let's say I give you the number of nails or the number of atoms, for example, of silver. How many moles is that? So we're gonna go, always begin with what you, you know, what you were given. So here we have 1.1 times 10 to the 22nd silver atoms. And then we ask, okay, for, since we have silver atoms on the top, I'm gonna put silver atoms on the bottom. And then I'm gonna put the number, sorry, moles, eraser. Okay, so we're going from silver atoms to moles. So guys, the mole pretty much always gets the one, because one dozen or one mole has 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms in it. When you guys are plugging this into your calculator, put parentheses around this number and parentheses around this number, because again, we don't want your calculator to get confused with the order of operations. Okay, so when we do this, guys, should you be expecting a big or small number? Hopefully you should be expecting it not a small number, because large number divided by large number is gonna give you a small number. So this ends up being point, now we're gonna do two sig figs because this is two sig figs. So 0.018, okay? Now that would be moles of silver here, okay? So you could also put this as 1.8 times 10 to the negative 2 moles of silver. Of course, I expect you to recognize both. If this was a multiple choice question, I could have either one of these answers. You should recognize them as the same. So remember, we did that in unit 1. Okay? So notice, it didn't matter, guys, when I'm trying to go from a dozen to the number of things in the dozen, I'm always gonna say 12, because one dozen of trucks is equal to 12 things. One dozen of donuts is equal to 12 things, right? So one dozen, I don't care whether it is silver atoms, I don't care if it's helium atoms, guess what? It's still 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd things in that one mole, okay? So go ahead and do this checkpoint, and we'll do that when you guys are in class, okay? Now, this allows me to go on further, because guess what? In the lab, we don't even have a mole scale, right? We have a mass scale. So we need to establish a relationship between the number of particles, moles, and mass. Now, this goes into the theory behind why we derive that 1 AMU is equal to 1 gram. But all I really need you to understand out of this, guys, is that, remember when we did the atomic mass, let's say for copper, the atomic mass was 63.55 AMUs. Remember atomic mass units? So that, what does that mean? That one atom of copper is 63.55 AMUs. And that's the number right under copper on the periodic table. But get this, we do not work with one atom at a time in a chemistry laboratory. We need to scale this up. So we're not talking about one atom at a time, We're talking about one mole of atoms at a time. In other words, you know, like we're saying, you know, one dozen of nails weighs 0.15 pounds. Here, we're going to say one mole of copper weighs 63.55 grams. Now, if you think about it, 63.55 grams is something that I can actually touch and see in the laboratory and I can work with. So it is more feasible for me. So get this. Whatever you used to figure out when I would ask you what's the atomic mass of, let's say, copper, if I just say what's the molar mass of copper, you're gonna replace the AMUs with grams per mole, okay? And we derive this, again, from Avogadro's number, because we are saying that Avogadro's number, which is the number of atoms in one mole, okay, is based on carbon number 12, which is 12 grams. So by process of deduction, 1/12 the mass of carbon 12 is also going to be 1 gram, which is 1 AMU. If you don't understand the logic behind this, it's not a huge deal, as long as you please get this correct. So, this brings us to talking about atomic weight, which is the AMU part, right? It's the mass of an element's atoms. But when we're not dealing with like helium atoms, right, or copper atoms, we're dealing with molecules, let's say like carbon dioxide, we call it molecular weight, guys. So this is just technicalities. It's molecular weight, the average mass of the substance molecules. If we are dealing with ionic compounds, remember we call those formula units, all right? So we say formula weight. So if I said, what's the formula weight for NaCl, which is an ionic compound, you'll just calculate that and put AMUs. Now, no matter what you're using, the mole, whether you're with molecular weight, formula weight, or atomic weight, the molar mass of any of these things is going to be the amount of mass in grams of one mole, or 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd molecules, formula units, or atoms. So together we call these particles. I want you to understand the definition of those, because you need to know what we're asking you for. Don't get confused if I ask for molecular weight, or if I ask for formula weight, or for molar mass. Just make that distinction for me. All right, speaking of which, let's do some examples, guys. What is the molecular weight / formula weight, again, depending on what you're dealing with, of the following? And then we need to say what their molar masses are. So C2H4, we all know that this is a molecular compound, okay? A molecular compound means we need to determine the molecular weight here, okay? How do you do that? Now, remember, with molecular weight, we're basically asking, what is the mass of one molecule of this? So you're going to give me this in AMUs, because that's the small one, right? So we have two carbons here. In each carbon, guys, look at the molar mass, or the molecular, the atomic weight of carbon. It's the one right under, right? So for now, just round it to two decimal places. If you're in lab, please put all the decimal places. Don't round, because you'll get round-off error in the lab. So this is 12.01 AMUs, okay? So 2 times 12.01, let's bracket this. There's more here. We have four hydrogens. What's the atomic weight of each hydrogen? According to the periodic table, the number below it, it's 1.01 AMUs. So when you sum that up, okay, 2 times 12.01 plus 4 times 1.01, this gives you 28.06 AMUs. Now, guys, this is the molecular weight. To figure out the molar mass, it's going to be the same exact number. You're just going to swap out AMUs for what, guys? Grams per mole. adding up and we're saying one mole of the stuff, which is C2H4, has 28.06 grams in it. All right, let's do for ammonium sulfide. Here, the correct way to answer this is formula unit, because remember, guys, this is an ionic compound, so we call it formula units. Now we're just going to call it formula mass. So how much, what are the amount of AMUs in one formula unit of this? So let's go ahead and work this one out. So be careful with this one. So we're looking at nitrogen. How many nitrogens are here? There's two of them. Don't forget that this two carries into the parentheses. So two times, and each nitrogen is 14.01 AMUs. So let's bracket that. Okay? So how many hydrogens are there? There's eight. Eight times 1.01 AMUs. Let's bracket that. Plus, we've got the last thing is sulfur, and sulfur, there's one of those times 32.07 AMUs. So multiply these out, sum them together. So 2 times 14.01 plus 8 times 1.01 plus 32.07, and this ends up being 68.17 AMUs if we were talking about one formula unit of this. But we want the molar mass, so what are we going to do? How much mass is in one mole? So we're going to replace that with grams per mole for molar mass. Okay? So let's do some ideas. Let's talk about some misconceptions about, you know, molar masses. So remember, guys, one dozen of anything is 12, right? One mole of anything is 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd. That does not change. But guys, one dozen of, let's say, large nails is still 12. One dozen of small nails is still 12, but their masses are different. One dozen of large nails is 0.3 pounds, and one dozen of small nails is 0.15 pounds, although we have the same number of nails. Same idea with molar mass, okay? So if you look at one mole of sulfur, according to the periodic table, has 32.07 grams. One mole of carbon has 12.01 grams. Both of these guys have still 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms, okay? The number, because they're both one mole, okay? However, one mole of sulfur is heavier than one mole of carbon. Please make that distinction for me. Here's another example. Look at this. Hydrogen through copper, all of them, okay, have 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd in one mole. However, for each of these, their molar mass is different. Hydrogen is the lightest. One mole, or 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms of hydrogen, weighs 1.008 grams, whereas copper, one mole of copper, that's 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms, weighs significantly more, which is 63.55 grams, okay? Now, I want to do some sample calculations with you guys with this one. So here, let's find the number of moles in 22.5 grams of sample of dry ice. Dry ice, guys, is solid carbon dioxide. So you started out with grams, you want to go to moles. So always begin with what you have, 22.5 grams of CO2. Now, since that's on the top, we're going to put grams of CO2 on the bottom, and we're going to bounce to moles. And yes, we can do that. How do we do that? We know the molar mass of CO2, correct? 1 mole of CO2, guys, is what? So let's run the calculation real quick. There's one carbon at 12.01 each, plus two oxygens at 16 grams per mole each. So 16.00, actually. I rounded that, but it is two decimal places. Okay? So when that happens, I'm going to do this as 12 plus 2 times 16. That gives us, 12.01 is what I should do. Times 1 plus 2 times 16. This gives us 44.01 grams per 1 mole. See? That cancels and we're left with moles. So 22.5 divided by 44.01 is going to be, now how many sig figs should this be? It should be 1, 2, 3 here, according to this number, the least number of sig figs. So it is 0.511 moles of CO2. All right, let us do the reverse of that. Let's calculate the number of grams of sulfur in 2.78 moles of sulfur. So now we're going backwards, but that's okay. You always begin with what you were given. So 2.78 moles of sulfur. Now, we're gonna go from moles of sulfur to grams of sulfur. 1 mole of sulfur is how many grams, guys? This should be easy because we don't even have to do molar mass. We just look at the number right under there, and this is 32.07 grams. So 2.78 times 32.07, 2.78 times 32.07, you should have gotten, and this is 3 sig figs, 89.2 grams of sulfur. Now, let us see about converting between grams of an element and the number of elements. By the way, guys, notice that when you are using, when you're going from grams to moles, the identity of what you are dealing with here, CO2 or sulfur, matters now. Because remember, different, although both, let's say 1 mole of CO2 and 1 mole of sulfur both have 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd particles in them, their masses are different. So be careful with that one. Now, let's go and find the number of carbon atoms in 0.58 grams of diamond. And diamond, just assume it's pure carbon. So we're going to go from 0.58 grams of carbon, can I go directly from grams of carbon, guys, to the number of atoms? I can't really do that. I have to stop by moles in between, right? So I can go from grams to moles, and then once I get to moles, then I can go to the number of atoms. So guys, 1 mole of carbon has 12.01 grams in it. Now, I'm not finished because the grams canceled, but now I'm going to go from moles of carbon to atoms of carbon. So be careful with this one because with these, there's no shortcut. You don't have, you have to stop by. When you go from grams, you got to go to grams, from grams to moles, and then moles to atoms. 1 mole is 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atom. So here you would do 0.58 times 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd, and then you would divide this by 12.01, and of course, you're gonna get a large number here. Let's squeeze that right here, and it's going to be to two significant figures, so 2.9 times 10 to the 22nd atoms of carbon. how that works, guys. Okay? Now, let's say that we're gonna do the reverse of that. Let me erase this to give myself some space. And this time I give you the number of formula units. Why did I say formula units? Because I'm dealing with sodium chloride here, guys, okay? So it's an ionic compound, so I use formula units. So we have 1.23 times 10 to the 24th formula units of NaCl, and I wanna figure out the mass. I can't really go from formula units or particles to the grams. I have to stop by moles first. So formula units to moles, right? And what, oops, one mole here has 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd formula units of NaCl. But I'm not done because I don't want the moles of NaCl. I want the number of grams. So I'm gonna go from moles to grams. How do I go from moles of NaCl to grams? I say one mole of NaCl and I calculate the number of grams in there. So guys, Na, sodium is 22.9, let me check that real quick. Let's see. That's correct. Okay, plus chlorine is 35.45, so this is 58.44 grams. And so that ends up canceling out and I'm left with grams of NaCl. So guys, make sure when you're typing this in, multiply everything on the top, divide by everything on the bottom, but make sure you put parentheses, depending again on your calculator, around your number when you type it in, just to really separate your numerator from your denominator, and then divide it by 6.02 times 10 to the 23rd. Again, put those numbers in parentheses. So you should be rounding to 3 sig figs, that's the least number that we have, which amounts to 119 grams of NaCl. So you see, guys, if you go from atoms, all or particles, let's say, all the way to grams, you've got to stop by moles. Moles is always like that thing in between that we convert to before we go on. Please go ahead and do these checkpoints, and we'll pick up here and talk about these when I see you guys next time. So guys, just wanted to tell you, Avogadro's number is very huge, right? So if you have 22 copper pennies, they contain 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd atoms in them, or that's about one mole. So one mole, you know, 22 copper pennies make one mole of copper, right? But if you had 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd pennies, that covers the Earth's depths to a surface of 300 meters, okay? So we'll pick up from here next time.